Okay, let's begin. Welcome to the June 4th meeting, 2024, the Rybrook Zoning Board of Appeals. With us today, it looks like we have four of the five members. So each application, and there being only one, you have the opportunity to delay this to a future date or be heard by the four. In order to be successful, you're going to need three out of the four members voting in the affirmative for any variance to be granted. With us this evening, we have Building Inspector Stephen Fews and Village Attorney Bob Zitt. David Heiser, who's the Board of Trustees representative, is unable to be with us this evening. He has been excused. Anyone making the presentation, please come to the podium, state your name, the nature of the variance, and your relationship to the applicant. The first item that I'd like to do is open the public hearing for this application. The application is number ZBA 24-003, adjourned from April 2nd, 2024, Joseph Nuremberg, 9 Country Drive, widened full length of driveway and installed stormwater management system. Motion open, public hearing.
So moved.
Open.
Second. Public hearing is open. Please come to the podium.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for coming out this evening. I know this is only one application, and it's a beautiful evening, and appreciate everybody coming. My name is Daniel Tartaglia. My address is 800 Westchester Avenue, Rybrook, New York. I'm an attorney, and I'm representing the Nirenbergs in connection with this application, 9 Country Ridge Drive in Rybrook, to widen their driveway. I didn't represent the Nirenbergs in March and was retained by them after that. And I was telling Mr. Nuremberg, when he called me on the phone and started to explain to me what had happened in the meeting in March and what his thoughts were about the variance that's being requested, I apologized to him this evening. I kind of blew him off a little bit. He was saying to me, well, Dan, this section of the code doesn't make a lot of sense. You know, there are parts in it that are not defined, and I'm frankly not sure that it even applies to us. And I said, look, this code is pretty tight. I've worked with this code, you know, most of my professional career, and, you know, I don't find many things in this code that don't make a lot of sense to me. So I listened to him, and in my preparation for this evening's meeting, I went back and took a look at it, certainly, and then I listened to the meeting in March and took very seriously, of course, all the board's comments. And when I read the section of the code, I kind of thought the same thing. In any residence district, except an RA-1 district, I thought, geez, that's odd. What's an RA? Where is the RA-1 district in the village? I don't know if anybody here knows. I had to pull out the map. So I pulled out the map, and I realized, oh, that's Avon Circle. Okay. So every residential district except Avon Circle, no unenclosed off-street parking facility. I thought, parking facility? Is that a parking lot? I wasn't exactly sure what that was. I looked through the code, and I didn't see it defined in the code. Shall be developed. I thought, this is just a driveway widening. It doesn't sound to me like it's a development, but developed within 25 feet of a front line, or shall be developed within 2.5 feet of a side or rear lot line, except as provided in G1D5 below. I went and read G1D5 below, and it really doesn't have anything to do with this application. So then I went through the code, and I thought, well, what's the difference between a driveway and an unenclosed off-street parking facility? Is there a definition of a driveway? I couldn't find a definition of a driveway. I did find a definition of a driveway in other codes, and basically what the definition was is a thoroughfare or an improvement or an impervious area for a vehicle to travel from point A to point B. Not park, to travel from point A to point B. So in the code where it requires properties such as this to show two off-street parking spaces, you have to show parking space. Now parking space, interestingly, is defined in the code. An off-street space, this is the definition of a parking space, an off-street space available for the parking of one motor vehicle and having an area of not less than 175 square feet. Well, that all made sense. Exclusive of passageways and driveways appurtenant thereto. So you can't even count your driveway as a parking space in proving that you have the sufficient off-street parking as required by the code. So my thought was, this section of the code, and there's no, unfortunately, you know, in local codes, there's no legislative history. You can't go back and say, well, what was the planning principle behind this? What was the legislature trying to accomplish? Because we're all tethered with this. Stephen's tethered with the code the way it is. You're tethered with the code the way it is, and so are we. So we either have to come and seek relief, which is what we're seeking, or maybe seek relief and maybe, and I'm disappointed that David's not here, because maybe this section needs to have somebody take another look at it. Maybe the planning board needs to take a look at this, make a recommendation back to the Board of Trustees, and maybe this section needs to be changed or modified or clarified, unless I'm completely wrong. And so I'm leaving myself to your mercy to explain to me, you know, where my logic is off.
What is the extension of your logic to the village of Rybrook in total?
Meaning?
Well, you're making the case for this particular situation, but extend that to the entire village of Rybrook. And if we follow the logic for this application, and we then continue to apply that to every driveway parking space in the village of Rybrook, what would be the implication?
Well, that's exactly my point, Mr. Chairman. Every driveway, if a driveway is considered a parking, an unenclosed parking facility, every driveway in every residential zone in the village that crosses through the front yard is in violation of this section.
Okay. I you know, there's a long history of this board interpreting the code, interpreting driveway, interpreting parking facility, and the word developed. And I think that you have to look at, this board is charged with interpreting that and applying it in a practical, consistent way. Consistent is very important, because what we do in one case, we need to be cognizant of what that's going to mean for future. So that's one issue. And I disagree with your concept that facility means building. Facility means...
Oh, no, I didn't...
Okay, but...
Excuse me to interrupt. That's not what I'm asking what it means.
Okay. Well, in a residential neighborhood, and I'll get to what something else said about the definition of a driveway, too, is that the development, in our view, is development that will take away green space, natural water, impervious, and you clearly recognize that by talking about putting in dry wells and the like, which we appreciate. But when you get to the definition of driveway as a passage through, okay, you could extend that to say, well, there's a one-car garage, passage through is straight down, they don't need anything wider. So I don't think that you can say that you, I think you're parsing it apart, parsing the two parts to it, and I think it actually hurts your argument, because it's not to widen it, he doesn't need a wider driveway right now, because he has a straight path to drive through.
Whether he needs it or not begs the question as to whether or not
needs
a variance for
but
it.
But one of the criteria, where can I see the resolutions? You know, one of the criteria that we have to observe is the benefits sought by the applicant can be achieved by some method feasible for the applicant to pursue other than an area variance. Okay, he doesn't need to widen the driveway to be able to drive out of his driveway. He wants the widening of the space for parking, not for driving, Because his driveway, if he's driving into the, where it's widened, that doesn't make any sense, because there's no curb cut, or whatever. So I think we need to focus on the, what, you know, rather than parsing, you know, if you look at the history of this board has been very accommodating to people's needs within reason. You don't see McMansions in Rybrook. You don't see people trying to put a three-car garage into a split-level house. And Mr. Nuremberg is not doing that, but we've had to face situations like that. Or I want to widen my driveway because I have five cars. That's not our issue, okay? We want to accommodate the people to be able to use their property comfortably without impinging on their neighbors or creating eyesores for the village or doing something that is going to hurt us in the future. So that's what we are looking at. We're looking at what is the precedential value. So from my perspective, I think that focusing this issue on a technical, your interpretation of the code, which is not how I would interpret it, is not going to get us anywhere. What I'd like to understand, by the way, I think it was the April meeting, because I was not at the April meeting. I was at the March meeting. So I think that their original thing was in April, not March. Just correct the record. That's all. Not a big deal. I'd like to, and you've submitted a revised plan. I'd like to focus on the revised plan, on how that works. And, you know, we try to accommodate, but we're not going to do something that is going to, we think, hurt the village or hurt the neighbors or create a precedent that we don't want to follow. So if you look back at our history, you'll see where people want to expand. We'll say, okay, you can do it, but here are the following conditions, because we want to limit the exposure. So I think that's what we should focus on. I think that's more productive, because we can't change the code. We're the board that's in charge with interpreting it. And for me, I'm not speaking for my fellow board members, I don't agree with your interpretation.
Thank you.
If I could just piggyback a little bit, I kind of agree with Steve. I'm not sure I agree with your interpretation completely. But one of the things that the five factors that you cite in your letter, I'm not sure I agree with a couple of them. And I understand my favorite line as a lawyer is who's right? Depends who's paying me. So I completely understand, you know, you try to make that argument. I'm not sure I agree. But the thing that Steve brought up was, you know, is less feasible. And I think there was some discussion during the meeting about not extending it straight, but having sort of an angle.
A hammerhead.
Right. Not even a hammerhead. No. Almost like a widened to the top. And the reason I actually remember that is I'm in the same position that the Nuremberg's are. I have that one-car garage with a singular driveway. And fortunately, and I am really thankful, I have that widened top, so I call it a Y. And unfortunately, this many years ago, they were able to put on a extension. I'm like kind of on a bend,
yep.
So they would never let me do it today, right? It was done way before I moved in. But I have what's a Y, so you have to kind of back down, and you can, but you can't put two cars near the bottom. So I'm kind of very sensitive to what they, because I wanted the same thing, but as I said, you know, especially with the factor more feasible, we could review that again, but that was something that did come up. And you know, I'd like to hear if that's even an option, but
there's a plan that was submitted, which yeah. is a longer, you know, it's wider at the top, it goes straight, and it's not a Y, right. But it doesn't go all the way down to the curb. So I'd like to explore, you know, what the rationale between this size that's in this revised plan.
I don't mean to dominate here.
No, Steve, I'm looking at the diagram in the submission. It's on page 23 of the PDF, of 23 of 35. It shows the Cultec units, and it has a picture of that driveway wide at the base of the house, and then cutting a little bit in, passing the 25-foot parking setback. Do you see that? Are you looking at that?
I have to put my computer on.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Here, Steve.
Right. Okay. Go ahead.
Now Steve said this was a revised. Was it a revised, or was that the original?
I was just asking my client that.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, our engineer was unable to make it.
Because it's listed in the table of contents as a revised plan.
This is basically the original.
Okay, then go to the next page, though.
One says the existing, and then the following one, I guess.
It's contoured out.
Yes.
A little bit further down.
Yeah.
Than the original. So, yeah, it's a little revised there. Because the other one was more rectangular. This has more of a swerve out. So
is that a plan, or is that the... That's the plan. That's not an existing.
That's not the existing, no.
So then the one in the other plan goes straight down.
Yeah, existing's one singular car.
Right. But then there's another plan. If you go to the next page, there's a plan where it's angular. It's a rectangle on the side, not curved. So I don't know which is the right proposal. Do you see?
Well, I don't have the hard copy yet.
Well, wouldn't they know what's the proposal?
Well, that's what I'm asking. Here. This one, see, that's straight down with a cut in. It says revised,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, this one looks like the original. And this one, from what I recall, first, this one looks like the revised.
Okay, so what we're talking, that's what we're on. Are we talking about the one with the curve?
Can I see it and show it to my clients?
There's this one here where it's curves in. Oh. And there's this one where it's straight down and cuts in.
I remember last meeting, I remember the bottom curved out both ways because Mr. Nirenberg was discussing the safety, the ease of turning and everything. So I remember it came, what I would call like a fishtail, almost it came to the bottom and then he,
an apron,
widened both sides.
So I'm not sure, I don't know which one we're dealing with.
Right.
So, Steve, do you have that diagram up?
Oh,
this is, it's page 23 of the PDF, and
it may not be, it may just be used to show certain dimensions.
Oh, is that, that's mine.
I'm not sure there's
okay, so what is the plan that we that this board is considering?
I would go with the first plan that shows the Belgian block, is that
yeah.
in the apron?
The cobblestones,
That's page 23?
Yes.
Okay.
You on that?
Mm-hmm.
Now, the 25-foot parking setback, there's a line going across, and it cuts the slab walkway. Now, if that is, in fact, the 25-foot dimension from the curb, you know, that's very restrictive. I mean, that is extremely restrictive, you know, in terms of what the applicant can do.
Well, it's very deep into the yard, you're right.
Very deep, very, very deep. So some relief, I think, is appropriate. What the board was concerned about was just how much relief to be able to do the kinds of things the applicant wants to do, but the smallest possible variance to get that done. I think that was our logic that we were following the last time. So I don't have a problem with expanding. It's just a question of how far down is it necessary to go.
And that's what I was trying to get to, is let's figure out what you want and let's see if we can get there. Okay? I think having it all the way down to a wider curb cut is not going to fly.
So a two-car width driveway, you're opposed personally to?
Personally, that's my
all view. The way
all the way,
way down
all the way rectangularly to the street, I think.
That is my personal view. I don't know what.
And I don't think this diagram is.
And in general, this diagram is not showing a widening.
Not showing that.
Not the one. That's why I want to know what our plan is. And I agree with Don that to hold you to that 25-foot parking subject, I think we all live in town. It would be a hardship. So we want to get to some point where we can give you relief that you could live with. We're not trying to say get out of here, but we need to have some.
Does anyone know, is there any setback issue to the left of that?
No, I don't. It's all this.
No.
No, no side setback.
They would show up that. No.
Can you show the width of that?
Yeah, do we know?
At the base of the house versus the width at street level. Can you determine that at all? Because I can't.
Right here.
I cannot.
Right here. What's this say?
Well, it's 18 feet on this one, this plan here. This is.
Well, wait.
This is what would widen the original one. That's 18 feet.
Is this what you mean about
page
that's
that?
Showing a rectangle.
Is that what you mean?
What we're looking at is not
existing.
A rectangle.
I think that's
you're
existing.
Looking at the curve, right?
Yeah. So why are they different? Without calling
this is
it revised.
Because
right.
Here's the tree and here's
yeah.
the garage.
Right.
Correct.
I just don't
right.
That
that's
this
existing.
One
that's
the
existing. So
right.
what we're talking about
on this one
is mushing
right.
this out here.
But it's
they're
but it's not
changing the
a rectangle all the way down like
no.
the one you had
it's
up there. So
the
curb cut's down here.
It's not a one car.
I don't think
so.
Go
right.
Okay.
I think the curb cut is.
Exactly.
Here's the curb cut.
But it looks like it's right next to the house. Right, if you go straight down from the garage, the curb cut is.
So we're actually looking at three different
oh, you're right.
diagrams.
You're right.
Now.
You're
Mr.
correct.
Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Sure.
The plan that
I hear the board. I understand what you're trying to do. I've spoken to my client. Unfortunately, our engineer couldn't be here. We think it probably behooves all of us to adjourn this to the next available meeting. So he can be here and so that he can answer these questions. And so in between now and then, he can interface with the building department and clarify any questions.
What I would suggest is that we have a plan that we said, this is the plan that you want us to consider. Take into consideration what we've said tonight, mm-hmm. which is going straight all the way down to a much wider is not going to work. We're willing to help you and get you some relief so that you can have a hammerhead or, you know, a parking area, a place to turn around so you're not backing all the way out. We're willing to work with you. But you've got to come to the podium.
And if I may, the plan that we had brought in the April meeting was not a plan that showed a double wide width straight down to the curb. It did curve in. Now, granted, even when it curved in, it was still wider than the existing driveway, yet narrower than a complete straight line to the street.
What is the length from the house to the street? No?
I'm not sure if it's in the plan. I've walked it off. It's trying to measure that myself.
Well, I'm not sure, but this is straight down from the house. So do we know how long the driveway is?
This is existing, this is proposed.
Well, that's what I thought.
Yeah. So he's showing 21.
That's 21
at
wide.
Its widest point.
Right.
He's showing 21 feet at the widest point.
This is 18.
And 18 at the curve.
But what is this? This looks wide. The at the curve.
This is existing.
I understand that, but 18 is wider.
Yes, yes. He is making it wider all the way down.
See, I guess if the idea is to accomplish some parking, why does the driveway curb cut need to be wider at the bottom?
Well, there was... You know, there's other reasons. There's other reasons why the applicant, the Nirenbergs, want to do this. And, you know, I mean, I can get into that again, but Mr. Nirenberg very clearly explained, you know, at the April meeting, a lot of it has to do with maneuverability, the way the driveway is accessed. I mean, making a right-hand turn into this driveway, the choices are pull left and go right, or go over a piece of your lawn. I mean, that's the direction they come from most often.
We heard that argument. I don't even want to use work. We heard that
discussion,
and. To be honest, I don't think it was very persuasive. You know, again, for me, like Steve spoke for me,
understood.
I'm on a curve on Winding Wood, and it curves, and vision's not great, but it's never really a problem. I have that same kind of issue pulling in, and I don't have that fishtail. And if I have to move a little wider to the left if I'm coming down one way or the other way, it's almost insignificant. I don't think there's so. I think I may have mentioned. I don't think there's so much traffic on that road that was. It wasn't a persuasive discussion for me that it was a safety issue, maneuverability.
Except that I'm agreeing with you. As I was reading it. As I was reading your comments, Joe, I was agreeing until he said, you know, there's oncoming cars around a blind turn, the way the street is situated. So the way Country Ridge Drive turns, cars coming this way are blind.
So
if they're out here and somebody's coming around here, there is a little bit of a visibility issue.
Yep, I still don't understand how hard is it to turn. I mean, I understand. I think the bottom of the driveway is a little narrow, right? It could be widened a little bit, I would think, but I think if you're coming off Ridge Street, make a right and then into the driveway, I think you could do it without cutting. Again, I'm not sure of the curve, mm-hmm. but it's I'm trying just to visualize
how this is the house, right?
How challenging that is, and it's
so. Is it just to make sure I understand, so we don't waste more time with the board? Yeah. Is it the consensus of the board that you do not want to see any widening at the street level, or you want to see less widening at the street level?
Personally, I would say less widening at the street level, and work on the smallest possible bump out for the two cars as you go down toward the driveway. As a matter of fact, yesterday when I left our meeting, in the middle of the day, the house across the street from you, the guy's backing out of his driveway into King Street. Okay, he had to wait a while, make sure there were no cars coming, but he backed out into King Street, not Country Ridge Drive, but King Street. And he just proceeded to go north on King Street.
Some people have a death wish. I don't know what
but,
to tell
but
you.
But if there's no car parked there and you want to be able to sort of back out so you can come down the driveway straight, we understand that. We get it. Okay, we've been faced with that issue before.
Many times.
And we're sensitive to it.
Is there any amount of widening within the first 25-foot setback that is acceptable if no parking can be introduced in that widening?
I think yes.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask Don.
I think there's something that can be acceptable.
Then I think the plan as it currently stands, even though it is wider than the existing driveway in the 25-foot setback, you can show does not introduce parking in that widening, based on the definition of parking in the code, which is 175 square feet.
But is it the smallest possible variance?
But it does conform to the code as it stands. So it almost gets back to the point of, do we need a variance if we brought forward a plan that technically meets the code as it stands today?
We are not going to give you the specifications. This board never tells you what you have to do. What we do is we react to the architect and the applicant's proposal. So
Steve is a great resource. So if you have a plan, talk to him about it. And if he comes to us and says, this is okay, we're going to listen to him.
Yeah. But you are correct. If it meets code, then you don't need a variance.
But
you're here because something doesn't meet code.
Right.
You're 25-foot.
I understand. And the requirement that the board grant the minimum amount of variance possible to satisfy the needs of the applicant is really not part of the statutory test anymore. We hear it.
Oh, it comes from the state as to what we're supposed to consider in granting a variance. It's not in the code. It's in how zoning boards are supposed to act.
I know where it isn't. I know where it is in state law.
Okay, so
it doesn't say that anymore.
Okay.
I mean, you can ask your counsel. We will respect your request, and we're going to work to try to make this.
I think it would be more helpful to have the engineer here, sometimes the engineer or the professional is the missing puzzle piece to the board. I also think that the board has an obligation to ensure that the variances that they're issuing are relatively de minimis, because it's something that the board is going to be bound by. So I understand that it's not in the state. guideline.
I also would suggest, before we approve the plan, that you apply for your tree permit to take the tree down.
I was instructed that following this, if we got approval from this board on the building permit, that then the tree permit would be the secondary action.
Okay, I just want to, what I don't want to do is go through all this and then have to say, you can't take the tree down.
Yeah, it's also in the code that it would be looked favorably upon with an approved building permit for tree removal.
Okay, I just...
If the architect is going to be here, I personally would appreciate if you can provide the length, width, dimensions.
Measurements.
From the base of the house all the way to the street level, with the widths at the appropriate point and the point where the bend ceases or begins, you know, whichever way you go up or down. Mm-hmm. That would be very, very helpful to us. And, you know, we could very easily give a green light situation to something that was that well documented.
And apologies if it wasn't clear in his...
That's okay.
No, listen. That's okay. The plans are for one purpose.
This is the process, and no apologies.
Yeah.
Necessary. We just we want to help, but we've got restrictions on us, and we have to be mindful of precedent and your neighbor, and you know, there's always the creep. You know, this is not a case for you, but somebody wants to, you know, build a porch out, and then the way Rybrook measures setbacks and whatever, it depends on what your neighbors do. If so, one neighbor goes forward, then the next one has, you know, it's a domino effect. So that is what we're supposed to do, is make sure that we stop those dominoes. So we understand.
You do see we're the last domino on the street.
Yeah. We understand the issues. We understand the vagaries of living in Rybrook with the split level houses and the curves, and we get it. We've heard it all.
One of the things you would appreciate with your time on the planning board was that when the code was developed, Rybrook has seen a lot of work-at-home situations with requests to blow out the doors so that they can have a private area to work professionally. And that was not in the mindset of the planning process that approved the bulk standards. So we're seeing a lot of homes now requesting to expand beyond those limits. And as you suggested, maybe the Board of Trustees needs to look at a couple of things, one of which is the realistic bulk standards with respect to the GFA on a lot of the R15s and R10. In our 20s.
We do appreciate your constraints. Understood.
And we have been very consistent in trying to prevent encroaching on the neighbors and big mansions, and, you know, we want to preserve what we can preserve. But we also understand the realities of living in this town.
Well, then... It's, you know, it's up to the board whether you want to...
What we suggest is that if you wanted to go back to your architect, see if you have a plan, talk to Steve. If Steve thinks that, you know, it can be approved, and whether we need a variance or not, he'll talk to us, and we'll go from there. But I think that this plan isn't detailed enough for us to make a decision. We need measurements.
And for clarification, as we go back to the engineer and continue to discuss... the issue is any improvement, any widening within the first 25 feet, if it was a foot, is an issue because this violates this section of the code about unenclosed parking structure.
And we're not opposed to going beyond the 25 feet.
Yeah.
To give you the
but relief. Within the 25 foot, if we added a foot of width,
yeah, because it's a variance. But we're willing to, you know, we recognize, and Don said, that if you just had up to the 25 feet, that's not very practical for you. We get it.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much.
Do you want to make a formal request?
Yeah, we'd request that this be put on the board's next available meeting.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Very good. Thank you. Okay. Bob, do we have to do anything on our side for that?
No. The request we leave it open. Made? We leave the hearing open, right? So moved.
Seconded?
Second.
Okay, good. All right, the last item on the agenda is the approval of the May summary.
So moved.
So moved.
Second.
Seconded. Okay. Those minutes are approved. Motion to adjourn.
So moved. Okay.
Second.
Seconded. Fine.
Don't talk yet because we're still in the room.
Hey, Steve, we've got to get something to change the file.